Hall Story Quest Audiobooks presents The Lost Children by Theresa Talbot, narrated by Cathleen McCarron. Prologue. Glasgow, 1958. The body had been wrapped in a piece of torn sheet, then stuffed into the box. Sally came in from the cold, stopping at the back door to stamp her feet and shake off the wet earth caked to her boots. They were miles too big and tied around the ankles with string. Her skinny wee legs were mottled blue with the cold. She caught Irene Connolly watching her from a third floor window, her face and hands pressed hard against the glass. She shooed her away, gestured for her to beat it, hoping to God she'd go back to bed before there was trouble. Sally's footsteps sent the rats scurrying for cover as she opened the door. Tiny claws scraped and clicked on the stone floor, their tails slithered like big fat worms. There were two boxes stored overnight in the pantry. She carried them through and laid them on the table beside a third. Each held a similar bundle, tightly bound, carefully wrapped, like tiny Egyptian mummies so small they could easily fit into one box. She pushed a strand of hair from her eyes, wiping the sweat from her brow at the same time. Despite the cold, beads of perspiration clustered on her forehead. Her thin shirt had become damp and it clung to her back from the sheer effort of digging into the hardened earth out in the yard. Her small, wiry frame concealed a surprising physical stamina. The mental stamina came from knowing no other way of life. Some said she was simple. "There's a want with that yin," they'd say. Sally let them think what they liked. The lid balanced precariously on top of the third bundle, which was still warm. It took all her weight to hold it down in place. A tiny bone cracked under the pressure, but she carried on regardless. She took a nail from between her teeth and hammered it into the wood. She did this with all six nails before being fully satisfied the lid was secure. As she wiped the sweat and mucus from her top lip, she stopped dead in her tracks. She pushed her ear against the makeshift coffin and froze. There was no mistaking the tiny cries from within. Chapter 1. Glasgow, 2000.
"Take this, all of you, and drink from it."
Father Tom Findlay held the chalice above his head.
"This, my blood."
The meagre congregation mouthed the words along with him. He looked out at his flock and could have wept. There were a dozen at best. They were mostly old, mostly women, and most of them had nowhere else to go, all huddled around the pews closest to the radiators. Still, at least he had a job. He took just one sip. Meticulously, he wiped the rim of the chalice clean with a linen cloth and handed it back to the old priest by his side before walking down the steps of the altar. He wanted to believe he carried the sacred body of Jesus Christ in his hands. He wanted to, but couldn't. A handful of people shuffled sideways out of the pews to get their daily bread. He was desperate to give them more, but he really had nothing left to offer. The first supplicant was too frail to shuffle the few feet to the altar. He went to her first. Walking over to her pew, he smiled, pretending not to notice the faint smell of piss, masked by thick, musky perfume.
"Body of Christ."
He tried not to gag as he placed the communion wafer in her slack mouth and looked away when her ulcerated tongue licked the crumbs from her parched lips.
"Amen,"
she replied, then wound her shaky, arthritic fingers round his and bent to kiss his hand.
"Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father."
Tom felt like a complete fraud as he prized his hand away and left her rocking back and forth, her milky eyes spilling with gratitude that the priest had gone to all that trouble. As he turned to go back to the altar, there was a collective sharp intake of breath from the congregation. He turned as the old priest stumbled towards him and fell to the floor. The weak autumn sunshine streaming through the stained glass windows gave his ashen face an undeserved, healthy pink glow. His catatonic stare was fixed on the crucifix. Tom rushed to his side and felt for a pulse, but there was none. Father Kennedy's frail body lay prostrate on the altar, the ultimate offering, the gold chalice by his side. The puddle of wine became a blood-red snake that trickled its way along the marble floor, reaching out for him, pausing briefly to lick its lips before creeping into his white cassock. Oonagh O'Neil popped a couple of aspirin in her mouth and with masochistic delight pushed the Dyson along the Persian rug, the only carpet in her West End home. It was becoming a daily ritual. She had a cat and asthma, but once or twice a week she'd get someone else to come and push it for her. Oonagh had good days and bad days. Today was a bad day. Time was meant to be the great healer, but not for her. All it did was close over the gaping wound, sealing it at the edges, but somehow trapping the grief inside. She missed her dad. Looking out of the window, she presented her own forecast. Dull and damp, with a warm front coming in from the west, but feeling cool in the northerly wind. One of her first jobs had been as a weather girl for a low-budget satellite television station. The gig had been easy enough. The hardest part had been finding ways to make wet and windy sound interesting. Squally showers had been a particular favourite. She had come a long way since then. Maybe too far, she mused. The shrill of the phone made her jump. The answering machine kicked in after three rings and Jerry's voice screeched through the house.
Oonagh, are you in? If you're there, pick up. Jeezo!
She raced into the hall and grabbed the receiver.
Hiya, what's wrong? What's wrong? Where the hell are you? No, don't tell me, in your house, on the phone.
Jerry was well used to Una's sarcasm.
You're meant to be here to record the trail for tonight's programme. We've only got the studio until... Oh, shit. Sorry, Jerry, completely forgot. Look, get me a cab and I'll be there in 10 minutes. That fat bastard Ross is kicking up a stink. You know what he's like. Troublemaking little... Darling, we're wasting time. Order the taxi now. I'll throw a bit of slap on my face and by the time he gets here, I'll be ready to shoot the crow.
Without waiting for a reply, she hung up and took the stairs two at a time to the spare bedroom that served as a massive walk-in wardrobe. A row of navy jackets, identical to the untrained eye, hung on one rail. She chose the Chanel, perfect over the plain white silk shirt and cream trousers she was wearing. It didn't take her long to put on her telly face. She had it down to a fine art. By the time the taxi was blaring its horn, she was blotting her lipstick with a tissue. Oonagh perched on the back seat and jotted down her script. As soon as it was finished, she called Jerry from her mobile and dictated it to him. That way he could get it on autocue before she arrived. 20 seconds was all that was needed, but she wanted to be ready to record as soon as she was inside the studio. Tonight's programme, an exposé of a Glasgow sunbed salon fronting a money laundering racket, would be the first in a brand new 6-part series, The Other Side. It was Oonagh's baby, a hard-hitting look at Scotland's seedier underbelly. The first 5 programmes were already in the can. The last one just needed a few finishing touches. And she could do without any more bother from the fat bastard. He'd been hell-bent on trying to scupper her plans from the word go. When she'd first presented the idea to Ross Mitchell, Oonagh had made it clear she intended to write, present and help produce the entire series. She'd been their main anchorwoman for over 3 years, presenting the weekday news each evening, but she was sick of the talking head routine and missed researching and developing her own ideas. Ross had dismissed the whole thing, told her it wouldn't work. Nothing wrong with the idea per se, he'd said. It was just that the public wouldn't take to her being aggressive, hard-hitting. If she wanted to branch out, why not try daytime? Oonagh had known he was talking a pile of crap and had gone above his head, taking her idea to Alan Gardner, head of news and factual programmes. Within a month, she had a full production team and the budget for a pilot run of 6 programmes. That had been 8 months ago, and Ross still had the hump. Petty bastard. Petty fat bastard. As the taxi neared the door of the studios, Jerry was out in the street, smoking a roll-up and pacing like an expectant father. Despite the obvious rush, he still had time for an over-the-top air kiss. He flapped his arms about his head. It's all right, I've covered for you. He was wearing a black T-shirt with a picture of Charles Manson on the front and He's Not the Messiah, He's a Very Naughty Boy printed underneath. Despite being in his mid-50s, his hair was carefully teased into short, orange and blonde tufts. I don't know what I'd do without you, Jerry. And she meant it. A good PA was vital in the business. One you could trust. Not just some ambitious wannabe who saw it as the first rung in the television ladder, a stepping stone to better things. It was the battle of the fittest in this game. The fans, who slavishly sent her mail, begged for a signed photograph, then perhaps a guided tour around the studio, were the same ones who the very next week would write to the studio bosses offering to work for nothing. It would only be a matter of time before her age and experience would be used against her, and the next bright young thing would be stepping into her Jimmy Choo's. She walked quickly down the corridor, straight through both sets of double doors into the studio and sat on the plush blue chair in front of the camera, crossing her legs at the ankle. She blew Ross a kiss, knowing he'd be watching from the gallery, cursing her not for being late, but because she was on time, leaving him little to moan about. The floor manager gave her a 5-second cue. Oonagh smoothed down her already immaculate chin-length bob. The red light came on above camera B. 3, 2, 1. As expected, she did it in one take. Oonagh O'Neil never made mistakes. Not on the air, anyway. Jerry gave her the thumbs up.
Brilliant!
That was his word of the month. As usual, he did the mother hen routine, unclipping her mic, teasing her hair, wiping away imaginary specks of dust from her shoulders.
Now, Alan Gardner wants you to pop your head in before you run off.
Alan's door was open, and he was perched on his desk, looking at the running order for the evening's news on his PC.
Hi, Oonagh.
He gestured to the chair for her to sit down.
Be with you in a tick.
He fiddled about with the order of the stories, changed the sequence, then changed them back to their original format.
There, that's better.
Oonagh said nothing, just grinned. She was used to Alan.
Oonagh, do you know if there's any footage of Father Kennedy kicking about?
Yeah, there must be loads in the library. There was a whole lot taken last year when he was doing those pro-life rallies. And the debate I did with him will still be in archives.
Why, what's the old git done this time?
Nothing, Alan said without looking up.
He's dead.
Oonagh gripped the arms of the chair.
Dead? Bloody hell. How? What happened? Died on the altar.
You're joking.
Hardly. The diocese is just off the phone. Collapsed during 11 o'clock mass, no less. A trooper, right to the end. Never missed a trick, did he? We'll give him 45 seconds in the second half. Just put a still picture up, but we'd best have a bit of footage on standby in case any of the other items get...
Oonagh didn't wait for him to finish.
But I was meant to meet him later. I had an interview booked. He called me last night and arranged it.
Looks like you've got the afternoon off then, doesn't it? What did he want to speak to you about anyway?
Oonagh felt a tiny prick of excitement.
I don't know, but he said it was important.
Ugh, you know what he was like. Probably nothing.
Nothing? Alan, I'd been badgering Kennedy for an interview for the Magdalene programme for months. Then, out of the blue, he called me.
Well, whatever it was, he's taken it with him to the grave.
Una's eyes widened. She opened her mouth to speak. Alan held up his hand.
Una, I'm teasing. Not everything's a bloody story. He must have been at least 120. He was going bloody gaga, for fuck's sake. He was always on the blower to me, spouting some nonsense or other.
Una stood to leave, her mind racing. Right, I need to crack on. My taxi's on wait and return, so... But Alan was only half listening, his attention already diverted by yet another crisis. Chapter 2. Glasgow, 2000. The pair drove from Govan Police Station in silence. Alec Davies felt like shit. He was tired. Tired and fed up. His eyes stung from 10 days of back-to-back late shifts, and a tension headache was beginning somewhere around the base of his skull. Despite the toothpaste and mouthwash, the taste of stale Glenmorangie lingered in his mouth. Last night had been heavier than usual. He was getting too old for this. He licked his front teeth, forcing his tongue up under his top lip. They headed south towards the old Crossmyloof ice rink, a supermarket for many years now, and left into Darnley Road.
"The good houses, eh?"
said the clown sitting next to him on the passenger seat. The silence had been too good to last. They had been thrown together 3 months ago, and it was supposed to be a 6-month attachment. He didn't know if he would last without thumping him. Bloody police graduate entrance scheme, what a load of shite.
"See this part of the shields?"
McVeigh continued, pointing out of the window, warming up for a full-blown session. Davies missed MacAndrew. He hadn't really believed him when he'd said he was retiring.
"Do you know how much the flats are going for around here?"
McVeigh continued. Old men retired, not 48-year-old guys. Christ, he wasn't far off that himself, but had joined the force later than MacAndrew. It would be 10 years before he could access his pension, and right now that seemed like a lifetime. McVeigh let out a long, slow whistle through the gap between his front teeth.
"Big money, that's what."
He nodded his head and widened his eyes. It was all right for MacAndrew. He could lie in bed all day if he wanted. Davies turned the radio up. Surely McVeigh knew he was getting on his tits. He had to. No one could be that bloody stupid. Although looking at that hair and that jacket, maybe McVeigh was the exception to the rule. Davies drummed his fingers on the steering wheel. He was bored with the conversation, bored with McVeigh and bored with life in general. He couldn't be arsed. He needed his bed. He flicked on the window wipers with his pinky as the first drops of rain spat onto the windscreen, then gripped the wheel tight enough to turn the knuckles on the back of his hands white. McVeigh opened his mouth to speak, but took one look at Davies' face and shut up. As usual, there were roadworks on the Kingston Bridge, down to one lane northbound. The fumes from the lorry in front wormed through the car's ventilation system and caught the back of his throat, and the rain smeared the muddy city atmosphere across his windscreen.
"Where are we going anyway?"
McVeigh asked. Davies double-checked the text message. A wee smile played on his lips. He hadn't exactly been a rookie cop when their paths had first crossed, but nor was he the embittered old sod he was now. She'd been different too. Well, had looked different anyway. The sparkle, the shine had always been there, but none of the polish, not in the early days. He glanced at his phone again. He knew where he was supposed to meet her, but it gave him something to do with his fingers, helping him to resist the strong temptation to poke them in McVeigh's eyes. Despite the weather, once they were off the bridge, it didn't take long to ease through the morning traffic into the West End. The rain was now falling in bucket loads. It created rivers along the blocked drains and the gutters and battered off the car roof so fiercely that McVeigh raised his voice an octave in case Davies couldn't hear him.
"Oh, Mary Hill!"
He pointed to the road sign.
"That's my old patch."
At least he hadn't said, "You can see my house from here," and for that Davies was truly grateful. He swung off the main road and into the side street, just as Oonagh O'Neil was locking her car. He pulled over and grinned, watching her dodge the puddles as she ran towards the pub and out of the rain. She waved when she reached the door, letting him know she'd get the drinks in. McVeigh's jaw hung open when he saw her.
"Bloody hell. Punching a bit above your weight there, you know."
"Ach, just shut up, eh?"
Davies slammed the door and walked away, leaving McVeigh to babysit the car. Chapter 3. Glasgow, 2000. Father Patrick Joseph Kennedy left his home in Galway in the 50s to cross the water to Glasgow. He was a grumpy old sod whose face was aye tripping him. Sadly, his ambition outweighed his achievements, and he was stuck being a crappy old parish priest for the whole of his sorry wee life. He was a miserable, twisted, self-promoting, sanctimonious old bastard who rammed his beliefs down the throats of people too close to meeting their maker and thus too petrified of eternal damnation to question them. But no one could deny he was a tireless fundraiser for the church. Each week he'd rub his hands in glee as his poverty-stricken congregation dug deep into their pensions to fill the collection plate, in order that he might live rent-free in a Victorian villa and stuff his fat face with the best of scran. Tom guessed he'd need to tweak a few of the details before the obituary would be ready to email to the Catholic press office. He'd been working on it all morning, and still that was the best he could come up with. He pushed back in his chair and flicked through the top few pages of the pile of admin on the desk beside him. It was all the usual crap. The diocese was raising funds and desperately needed cash to send a terminally ill father of four to Lourdes. The budget for his drop-in centre was being slashed, and a notice from Glasgow City Council warned that unless he got a special catering licence, the health and safety executive would fine him for serving hot food to down-and-outs. He stuffed the whole lot in a drawer and went back to the obituary. It was getting to be a bitch of a week. Everything was a struggle these days. The obituary should have been a doddle. Father Kennedy was a news editor's dream. Despite his age, he'd been well on the way to becoming a media darling, a moral crusader, popping up at every pro-life rally, every anti-abortion demonstration, and every let's-get-my-face-in-the-papers photo opportunity. He never missed a trick. No point in doing good if no one knows about it. But to die on the altar, to drop dead in front of his congregation, well, he had to hand it to the old bugger. It was the ecumenical equivalent of being killed in action. Tom thought of the last few months before Father Kennedy died and grabbed at his clerical collar, throwing it onto the desk. It was starting to choke him like a noose round his neck.
"Two gentlemen to see you, Father."
Mrs. Brady was at his back, and Tom slammed both hands down on the keyboard, deleting the incriminating evidence and almost rebooting his computer at the same time.
Would you be able to knock first in future, please?"
Mrs. Brady ignored him and shuffled out of the room, glancing over her shoulder at the computer screen and then shifting her eyes to Tom before closing the door.
"D.I. Davies?"
The older of the two men held out his identity card.
"And this is D.S. McVeigh, Govan Police,"
he added without looking at his partner. Tom noticed Davies was wearing casuals, though the Doc Martens, buffed to a high polish, would have given him away. McVeigh had a shock of ginger hair which frizzed at the temples. His jacket hung limply from his shoulders. Too many late nights walking home in the rain.
"Police? What's wrong? What is it?"
There was nothing Tom could do to stop the nerves that had risen from his bowels, turning his stomach into a knot. He clasped his hands firmly behind his back to stop them trembling. Shiny Shoes took charge.
"Right, Father Findlay."
"What? Oh, please, call me Thomas. Tom."
He ushered the pair to sit. Davies remained standing and drew a look at McVeigh, who by this time was crouched on a footstool, his elbows resting on his knees. Tom supported himself on the oak desk and nodded at Davies to continue.
"Nothing to worry about, Father. Just routine. We always do a follow-up in the event of a sudden death."
"You're here about Father Kennedy?"
"Aye. Known him a long time."
"Right. Let me see."
Tom crossed his arms over his chest and tried to look blokish.
"I've been assigned here for the past 4 years, so I suppose I knew him reasonably well. Why?"
McVeigh was picking at a loose thread on the fabric of the footstool. Davies leaned against the mantelpiece.
"Anything about his behaviour over the past few weeks that seemed, well, odd in any way?"
No, I don't think so. I mean, what do you mean odd?"
"Did he have a lot on his mind, for instance? Anything troubling him?"
"I'm not really sure. No, he didn't. Look, why are you asking questions about Father Kennedy? This doesn't sound very routine to me."
"Know anyone who didn't like him?"
Tom stole a sideways glance at his now benign computer and rubbed the palm of his hand over his mouth.
No, he was really quite well-liked, actually."
"No enemies that you knew about?"
"Enemies?"
A flutter stirred in Tom's chest.
No, of course not. For goodness sake, he was a Catholic priest."
"Nonetheless,"
Davies continued,
"he was a bit... Well, let's face it, he made few friends on the outside with his extreme views."
Tom used the back of his hand to wipe the beads of sweat that were forming on his top lip. He felt duty-bound to defend his dead colleague and his own need to wear the collar.
"They may seem extreme to you, but they are the views of the church."
"You all right there, Father?" said Davies.
Tom wasn't touched by his mock concern.
"I'm just a bit, you know, surprised at all this."
He gave up on the blokish stance and sank back into his chair.
"What's going on here?"
"Nothing. Honestly, look, are you sure you're all right? You're looking a wee bit pale."
Tom nodded his head and bit the inside of his mouth.
"Right you are, then."
Davies gestured for McVeigh to stand up. Tom was glad to see the back of him. The obituary lost its importance after that. He tried to start again, promising himself wee treats and rewards if he finished, but the words just swam on the screen in front of him. He felt panic swell in his throat, and he felt sick. He cooled his head on the window just in time to see Oonagh O'Neil get out of her car. He'd forgotten all about their meeting. She waved as she jogged up the steps. She looked as Irish as her name suggested, small, slim, with chestnut hair and deep blue eyes. He was sure if he went to Dublin, the streets would be lined with thousands of Oonagh O'Neils, and all just as pretty. He ran into the hall and opened the door before she had a chance to ring the bell.
"Hi, Oonagh. Good to see you. Come in.
He tried to sound light-hearted and hoped she couldn't see him shaking. He was fooling no one. She walked under the arch of his arm and flashed him a smile. He breathed in her scent. She winked at him, reading his thoughts.
"Old Spice?"
His face turned scarlet, and he rubbed the burning colour from his cheeks. He always looked forward to seeing her. She flirted with him outrageously, despite the fact he couldn't be interested in her, wouldn't be interested in her. But in her, he felt he had the closest thing to a friend. His biggest sacrifice when he joined the priesthood hadn't been giving up sex. In fact, in Tom's case, that had been relatively easy. No. Giving up on friendship had been the biggest single hardship, and there were times when the loneliness crushed him. But fortune had looked down upon him the day it had sent Oonagh O'Neil, and all because he'd been assigned by the press office to work as an advisor on a documentary she was making about the Magdalene Institutions. Tom, I'm really sorry about Father Kennedy. It must have been a huge shock to you. He was about to answer when she interrupted him. Good God, you look terrible. Has it really affected you that much? So she had noticed too. He knew his blushing had long since subsided and that a yellow, waxy pallor had taken over.
Christ, Oonagh!
He let his guard down and dropped his head to his hands as a wave of despair washed over him. Sometimes he forgot she was a journalist and that he needed to be careful of how much he told her. Sometimes he forgot he was a priest. Look, we don't have to go through this lot just now, she said, waving her hands over her research notes. Have you eaten? He shook his head. She took charge. Good. Get your coat, sunshine. We're going out. The restaurant was fashionable and expensive. The waiter recognised Oonagh immediately and nearly fell over himself to reach them. Once they were seated, Oonagh reached across, held his hand and looked directly at him. Tom, if you'd rather not talk about it, that's...
I'm fine.
He eyed the name written in gold on the window and smiled.
You know who St. Jude is, don't you? Patron saint of lost causes?
Her grin beamed from ear to ear.
Is that why you brought me here?
He took refuge behind the ridiculously large menu and swallowed hard as he clocked the prices. He gave a weak smile and tried not to let her see how out of place he felt. Pride, envy and avarice had already reared their ugly heads. Now gluttony crooked a finger and beckoned him to take the plunge. Tom knew when he was beaten and gave in gracefully. He looked at her and smiled.
Right, let's order, she said.
I'm ravishing.
You mean ravenous, he replied.
No, I don't, she grinned without looking up.
At least they'd escaped wrath and sloth. With Oonagh, lust always appeared to be waiting in the wings. Oonagh topped up his glass as they started to eat. Already he could feel the wine relaxing him. Tom, she said once the waiter was out of earshot, can I tell you something?
Go on,
he said, easing back in his chair, finally feeling comfortable. It's about Father Kennedy.
Yes?
Tom paused before placing his glass on the table.
What about him?
She gave him an awkward grin.
Look, promise you won't laugh.
Go on,
he said.
Well,
he watched her bite her bottom lip.
It's just that I think, well, I think there's something not quite right about his death.
Tom did as she asked. He didn't laugh. Chapter 4. Glasgow, 2000. Oonagh walked barefoot down the aisle of a derelict church to find Father Kennedy's parched corpse waiting to give her communion. When he placed the host in her mouth, his fingers crumbled and turned to dust. He tried to open his mouth to speak, but his lips had been sewn together with rough black thread. She woke up terrified, remembering the ghost story her dad had told her about a priest dying on the altar and coming back to finish Mass.
Honest to God, Oonagh.
He'd cross his heart to give the story authenticity.
And whoever had the misfortune to see the ghost of a priest?
He'd draw his finger across his throat in a theatrical movement, then nod his head. Her mother, of course, always backed him up.
Sure, hadn't the very same thing not happened to a friend's cousin? Why, hadn't he fallen asleep during Mass and woke in the pitch black to see the ghost of some old priest praying on the altar? You know what happened to him, don't you?
Oonagh would sit on his knee, eyes like saucers, already knowing the answer. The story scared the living daylights out of her. When she was at Mass, she'd sit nipping her thigh in case she dozed off. She was at least 12 years old before she realised that not all her dad's stories were true. She'd left the church behind a long time ago, along with other childish things, but in the hours before dawn, that story still had the ability to terrify her. Oonagh drifted in and out of a fitful sleep until it was time to get up. Then it was a struggle even to open her eyes. At least the morning brought some degree of normality. The traffic building up outside on Hindland Drive, and the cat driving her mental by scratching at the kitchen door to get out. She slid out of bed and pulled on a shirt before heading downstairs. By this time the cat was head-butting the back door, obviously desperate for a pee. He'd belonged to her dad. She'd thought it would be nice to have a wee cat around, but all he did was eat, sleep, shit, and make her face itchy and blotchy if he got too close. She carried her mug of coffee into the front room and fished the colour-coded inhalers from her bag. The brown once a day, the blue four times a day if she was feeling breathless. She had a green one too, but just kept it shoved in the back of a drawer and kept her fingers crossed that her asthma would never get that bad. She took two puffs of the brown and waited a few minutes before lighting her first cigarette of the day. Ordinarily, she'd switch on the television, catch the early news, watch the events of the day unfold. But not today. She took a last long draw on her cigarette, squashed the butt flat into the ashtray, then switched on the video to take another look at the previous night's airing of The Other Side. Although she'd seen the finished version before it had gone on air, she'd been too nervous to watch the transmission. Seeing it again now, she had to admit it was good. Bloody good. She looked forward to today's production meeting. Usually they were a waste of time, a group of navel-gazers eating trays of deli sandwiches and getting high on showing off. But today's would be different. The doorbell rang and she pressed pause. The screen froze on the sunburnt face of a startled woman coming out of a tanning salon to find a film crew peering at her. Jack stood on the step, jangling his car keys against the side of his leg. He was pale and looked like he'd lost weight.
"Can I come in?"
She opened the door a little wider and nodded her head. He hesitated before skimming a kiss on her cheek as he walked past. The cheeky bastard gave her bare legs the once over. A mixture of anger and emptiness flooded through her. "What do you want, Jack?"
"Can I sit down?"
"Look, can we just get this over with? I assume you didn't come for a cheer."
"Straight talking as usual."
He gave a reluctant, half-hearted grin, the hint of a nervous laugh at the end of his sentence. She said nothing.
"I don't want you thinking.
Jack, you have no idea what I think." They had first met when he was a guest on a debate programme she'd hosted. He'd been charming but had made little impact on her. She was used to being chatted up, and by bigger and more powerful men than him. It had been months before she saw him again, at a charity ball to raise money for some good cause or other, cash for kids forced to wear last year's trainers or something. It had been 8 months since her dad had died, 9 months since she'd had sex, and he'd been wearing a tuxedo. Inevitable, really. Lame excuses for sleeping with another woman's husband, but the only ones she'd ever been able to come up with. Cat came through and snaked his way around her legs. She reached down to stroke him. "Funny animals, cats," she said, tickling the soft fur under his belly. "They start off fluffy and kittenish. After a few months, they play less and start clawing at the door, demanding freedom. That's their hunting instinct kicking in. They always prefer the chase to the catch." Jack was looking out of the window at his car parked on the double yellows. She could have throttled him. "Jack, I think it's obvious what's going on here. There's no need to give this whole bloody thing a post-mortem and drag it out any longer than necessary. Oonagh, please. Don't Oonagh please me. I haven't heard a word from you for 3 weeks. 3 weeks. You haven't even had the decency to call me or even send an email. Jesus Christ, Jack! He kept trying to cut in, but she'd rehearsed the speech for a fortnight. You could have been man enough to face up to me. Don't treat me like a bit on the side. In the dry runs, she was calm and sophisticated. But now she was yelling, and when she stood up, she remembered she wasn't wearing any knickers. She tugged her shirt down over her thighs. And then you turn up at my home, unannounced. I'm not allowed anywhere near your home, yet you think it's all right to just march through my life whenever you can be bothered. Jack just sat with his head in his hands, staring at the floor. Oonagh wandered through to the kitchen and pulled a pair of sweatpants from the tumble dryer before topping up her coffee. Want one? He glanced up, taking this as some sort of truce, and nodded. She gave him two sugars instead of one and topped his mug up with boiling water from the kettle, hoping he'd scald his tongue. She knew she'd lost the war, but there were a few battles she could win. In the first few months, she had dug her heels in, refusing to be bowled over by him. It was just a bit of fun, after all. Kept him at arm's length. But inch by inch, she pulled her just that bit closer. They traded all the usual crap, the pasts and backgrounds, the hopes and dreams. And just when she dipped her toe in the water, just when she allowed herself to be seduced by the cosiness of it all, he snatched it away. What did she expect? A sodding engagement ring? She handed him the mug. Jack, have you ever heard the song The Snake? He shook his head as he blew on the coffee. Well, she said, it's an old northern soul song. It's about a woman who finds a half-dead snake by a riverbank. The snake begs her to help him. She's scared at first, but takes him home anyway, warms him up, feeds him, and cares for him until he's well again. She even allows him to sleep on her pillow. Then one day, he turns round and bites her. And as she's dying, she asks him why he turned on her after all her kindness. And do you know what he says? Jack shrugged his shoulders, sucking in cold air and trying to cool his scalded tongue. He turns round and says to her, "I'm a snake, you stupid woman. What did you expect me to do?" Jack opened his mouth to speak, but nothing came out. She let rip. "It was you who started all the crazy chat about having a future together. I knew the score, Jack. I never once asked for anything from you. But you were always talking about," he butted in, "having 10 scabby wains climbing over my S-type." She didn't laugh at his pathetic attempt at slang and his posh Kelvinside accent. He stretched out his hand, but she didn't take it, just glowered at it, chewing on her bottom lip. "Fool me once, Jack, shame on you. Fool me a second time, and you're a total bastard." She lit another cigarette, sat down on the settee opposite him and crossed her legs. He'd given up on the coffee and the mug sat on the table between them. "I just don't understand," she said. "Is this all a game? For months you were all over me like a rash, then suddenly you're avoiding me like the plague. Are you that shallow? Once you've made your conquest, it's no fun anymore." "It was just all getting a bit..." He hesitated while he chose the right word. She chose it for him. "Heavy?"
"I didn't say that, Oonagh. That was your word."
She got up and walked over to the window, wondering where the hell all the traffic wardens were when you needed them. "You've changed. I just feel I don't know you anymore." "Everything's so fucking black and white with you, Oonagh. I don't need this just now. I've got enough crap in my life. I can do without you acting the drama queen because you're not getting enough attention, fuck's sake." He stood up to leave. This time she reached for him, struggling over her wounded pride. "Jack, has something happened? Are you in some kind of trouble? Are you taking drugs or something?" She sounded like her mother. He let out a snort.
apart from the odd joint you roll me. No, no drugs. I know doctors get all the best shit, but you can rest assured, Oonagh, it's nothing like that.
He looked at his wrist, using his watch as a prop.
Look, I really have to go. I'll call you.
She watched him walk away. Don't fucking bother, she thought, and slammed the door behind him. Chapter 5. Glasgow, 2000. It wasn't even midday and she was shattered. Her row with Jack had left her drained. Too much shit was going through her head. She drove through the West End to the studio. As usual, the traffic was thick on Byers Road, but for once she was glad. It gave her a few extra minutes to get her act together. She put on the Joni Mitchell CD, stopping at the second track, which told the story of thousands of poor unfortunates over the years. It would make a good backing track for the Magdalene programme when it was finally ready. The research was proving painfully slow. Oonagh had spent months at the National Archives, sifting through census reports, workhouse records and court documents going back centuries. Some of the information was online, but a fair proportion was still only accessible in hard copy. She rather enjoyed holding the original documents in her hands, especially the records from Lochbridge House. The few grainy photographs she had found showed a huge Victorian tower that grew out of the ground, with uniform rows of bleak windows. The red sandstone bricks had been blackened by generations of soot and misery. To Oonagh, it looked independently evil, a malevolent entity casting its shadow across the city, corrupting everything it touched. But the building had been razed in the 60s, all trace of its existence obliterated. And getting accurate information on the home was an arduous task. Oonagh had phoned the Catholic press team every day and even turned up in person once a week, but they'd refused to play ball, initially denying any involvement with Glasgow's Magdalene Institute. After months of painstaking legwork, Oonagh had feared they might have been telling the truth. She'd been surprised to discover that many of the homes outside Ireland, including the very first, in London, had not been run by nuns at all, but by other Christian denominations, often with significant state involvement, or complicity, as she preferred to think. Dumping grounds across the world for women shunned by society. She knew she'd have to shoehorn that integral detail into the finished programme. She'd been about to throw in the towel when she discovered the vital piece of evidence she needed. It had been with a mixture of nerves and excitement that she'd made the final phone call to the diocese.
Hi, Dennis. It's me again. Now, I know you're not aware that the church had any dealings with the Magdalene Institute in Glasgow, but I've discovered the strangest thing.
Really?
The voice at the other end was dry, with a hint of sarcasm.
Listen to this.
Oh, I'm all ears, Oonagh.
The bill for demolishing Lochbridge House was actually paid for by the diocese. Now, does that not seem strange to you, that the church would pay to bulldoze a property it didn't own?
I'm assuming you can back this up.
She said nothing.
Well, it was a very long time ago, Oonagh. Perhaps the church paid for the work as an act of charity.
Una's smile could be heard down the phone. She launched into her final assault.
And then what do you think? Yes, you've guessed it. The diocese actually sold the plot on to private developers. Now, why on earth would they do that with a piece of land they didn't own? Would that be strictly legal, Dennis?
Aye, all right, Oonagh, you've made your point.
She'd been to university with Dennis Flatley, or Dennis Flattery, as she called him. For a time they'd worked together as reporters at Radio Riverside, just outside Glasgow, where the managing director had bullied the staff into wearing paper hats on a Friday to prove how much they enjoyed their jobs. Their paths had crossed fairly regularly over the years. With his gift for the gab and his aversion to hard work, it had been inevitable that Dennis would end up in PR. He eventually gave in and offered her Father Thomas Findlay to help her with her research and to ensure that he could act as a technical advisor on the programme. Oonagh knew it was more a PR exercise than any gesture of goodwill, an attempt at damage limitation. Dennis was no fool. Each new day seemed to find the church at the centre of a fresh scandal, a new ecumenical skeleton in the closet. Give him his due, Oonagh thought. He knew how to play the media at its own game. A white van beeped its horn behind her. She stuck the car into first and crawled for 3 yards before having to stop again. The rooftops of the new flats built on the Lochbridge House grounds could be seen across the skyline of the Hillhead tenements. Oonagh tried not to let herself be haunted by the ghosts incarcerated in those huge living tombs. How many poor creatures had lived and died there because no one had cared enough to take them home? Oonagh pulled into her reserved parking bay. She was the last to arrive. It took her twice as long as normal to reach the office for people stopping to congratulate her on the previous night's programme, but she liked to make an entrance. By the time she reached the meeting room, her ego was well massaged, and the ghosts of Lochbridge House had been stuffed to the back of her mind. Alan Gardner stood up as she entered, grinning from ear to ear. On the desk, a bottle of champagne stuck out from an ice bucket. Bottles of wine and beer rattled on the drinks trolley behind him. A dent had already been made in the tray of deli sandwiches. Ross Mitchell stayed in his seat, licking the mayonnaise from his fingers. The rest of the team gave her a mock round of applause and Oonagh affected a theatrical bow. Alan stepped forward and gave her a hug.
Oh, it was great, Oonagh. Well done. And guess what?
Oonagh was in no mood for guessing games, but didn't want to appear churlish. What? What? She shook Alan gently by the shoulders. Tell? What is it?
Well, he said, dragging it out, we don't have all the facts and figures yet, but initial results from the audience focus group are very positive. They love it. And...
he stretched out the word, looking round to make sure the whole team was paying attention. Nodding his head, he continued,
and the good news is, the head of factual programmes for the network was on the blower this morning.
He gave the word network imaginary inverted commas with his fingers. Oonagh wished he'd just get on with it.
He saw the VT and he wants it. The other side is going national, Oonagh.
The whole team let out a whoop and jumped around the room giving each other hugs and high fives. Even Ross made a half-hearted attempt at joining in, making sure he didn't miss out on the chance to bask in reflected glory. Oonagh waited until her glass was empty, then made an excuse to slip outside, needing just a few minutes alone. She punched the air outside the bathroom, yes, then ran in and threw up. Chapter 6, Glasgow, 2000. The circus had begun. Tom had been summoned to the Archdiocesan office in the centre of the city. He took his car as far as the suspension bridge and then walked the rest of the way in the cold sunshine. His legs were heavy as he dragged his feet along Clyde Street. He was already exhausted. The morning's confession had been mental. Normally they were lucky to get 2 or 3 penitents, but Father Kennedy's sudden death had acted like a magnet for all the local loonies. The church had been crammed. Not everyone had felt the need to confess, though. A few had just loitered, staring at the altar, miffed at missing the action. The office was tucked away behind St Andrew's Cathedral, which always reminded Tom of the Louvre in Paris, a historical building with a modern glass structure trying to steal the limelight. In the cathedral's case, the offending edifice was St Enoch's shopping centre. It was a long time since he'd been to Paris. He wished he were back there now, melting into the crowds. Just a guy, not some holy man who was supposed to know the answers. The roads were dead. It was the first day of a petrol strike, and already the country was acting like it was in the grip of a fuel crisis. The relative peace and quiet did nothing to calm him, only gave him space to think, and right now that wasn't such a good thing. He stood on the edge of the pavement for a few moments and considered his options. He could go for a drink before facing the ringmaster. There was plenty of time. But he quickly decided against it. Not because he'd be an unusual sight in a Glasgow bar, but because today he needed a clear head. He could just not turn up. Or he could have the decision taken for him. He closed his eyes, waited a few moments, and then ran blindly across the road. The deafening blare of a horn told him in no uncertain terms to get out of the way, and he ran terrified to the other side with his eyes and mouth wide open. His whole body was shaking. He was truly losing it. He steadied himself against the lamppost. He was still trembling when Charlie Antonio emerged from the building and blocked his path.
"Sordid business about Father Kennedy, eh, Thomas?"
"What?"
"Not every day a priest is bumped off in Glasgow."
Tom squared up to him, careful not to raise his voice.
"But that's rubbish. Who told you that? Anyway, what would you know?" "Oh, come on, to grips. I'm a journalist, Tommy boy. I've got contacts."
Antonio pulled on a pair of sunglasses. Tom wanted to lamp him, but was too scared.
"You're behind this, aren't you? It was you who got the police to come sniffing round. How bloody stupid am I?"
"Ach, stop being such a tit." And that's exactly how Tom felt, like a right tit. His right leg trembled uncontrollably as he struggled to keep his voice calm and steady.
"Okay, Charlie. So now what?"
He tipped his chin towards the building.
"Who did you speak to up there? And what did you say?"
"Ah, oh, you know me. Height of discretion and all that. Don't worry, Father. The men in black are keeping stoom. I only got as far as the receptionist, torn face old cow. But let's face it, Thomas, it's only a matter of time. They'll need to speak to the press sooner or later. I mean to say, it'll look a wee bit sus when there's a dead priest and no bloody funeral."
"No funeral?"
He looked straight at Tom.
"Crying out loud, do you need me to draw a diagram, Tommy? The police'll no let him be buried until they work out what the hell happened to him. Do me a favour, Tommy, never leave the church. You wouldn't last 5 minutes in the big bad world."
He shook his head and let out a snort as he turned his back and walked away. Gallus as fuck.
"Help the homeless, Father."
The big issue seller appeared from nowhere. Tom had no change. He muttered something pathetic and patted his pockets as proof before walking towards the entrance.
"Thanks a lot, Father. Thanks a fucking lot."
Tom made his way to the office on the third floor. A grey nun wearing a grey habit and a grey knee-length skirt sat behind a desk in the corridor, staring at a computer screen.
"I'm here to see Father Watson. I have an appointment. I'm Father..."
"Yes, of course," she interrupted, pressing her index finger on the intercom, announcing his name. "They'll be with you shortly."
"They?"
A thin smile spread momentarily across her lips as she went back to her computer. Tom watched the clock on the wall behind her head. It was a full 5 minutes before the light on the intercom flashed and she ushered him into the room. The office was modern and impressive, with a clear view over the Clyde and the south of the city beyond. On the wall hung an antique crucifix inlaid with mother of pearl. A collection of rare, leather-bound religious manuscripts was displayed in a bookcase in the corner. Tom thought of the big issue seller outside. Father Watson stepped forward and offered a nicotine-stained hand. A smouldering cigarette perched precariously in a dangerously overflowing ashtray on the desk. Tom's heart sank when he saw Davies and McVeigh. Davies was standing by the window. Tom noticed he was nibbling his pen the way ex-smokers do, and staring at the cigarette with apparent longing. McVeigh loitered by his side, his hands thrust deep into his pockets. His red hair had a life of its own.
"Nice to see you, Thomas."
Father Watson's vigorous handshake was almost strong enough to crush the fragile bones in Tom's knuckles.
"What's with..."
Tom glanced at the two policemen. Father Watson kept shaking just a second longer than necessary and looked Tom straight in the eye, squeezing his shoulder in mock concern.
"Don't look so worried, son. You've nothing to be afraid of," he said,
in a way that made Tom feel he had every reason to feel afraid.
"We just need to clear this business up."
"What business?" said Tom, wriggling from under his grip. "What's going on?"
He was speaking to Father Watson, but looking at the two cops.
"Oh, for God's sake, calm down, Tom."
Father Watson sounded mildly irritated. D.I. Davies put his chewed pen in his top pocket.
"Did you know Father Kennedy was allergic to penicillin?"
"Eh? Yes, of course I did. Why?"
"Well, the post-mortem examination revealed quantities of the drug in his body. Any idea how it got there?"
"No, of course not!" yelled Tom. "Don't you think I would have mentioned it if I did? Jesus Christ!"
Davies raised an eyebrow, looked more amused than shocked. Tom was past caring. He didn't like Davies.
"Did you know Father Kennedy was trying to get you transferred to another parish?"
"Oh, hang on a minute.
What did you two argue about the day before he died?"
Tom looked at Father Watson.
"Oh, thanks."
"Well?"
asked Davies. The room was stifling, and the stench from the overflowing ashtray was making Tom's stomach heave. He slumped into a chair.
"Tell me you don't think I actually gave him penicillin."
Davies bit the inside of his cheek and sort of shrugged. McVeigh picked at a loose thread on his cuff, but was obviously taking in every word.
"Deliberately," Tom said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.